What China's done for the last 50 years has been extraordinary. But so much of that has come from a different model. I mean, we look at China over the last 50 years, massive amount of surplus, inexpensive, incredibly efficient labor. None of those things are going to apply to China's growth model going forward.
There have been times over the past 25 years that I've gone back and forth to being an admirer to being a skeptic. And unquestionably, there are things that China will have difficulty with. For one, the fact that in a society where thought is controlled, and let's face it, thought is controlled in China far more than most other places, I think it is very difficult to be truly innovative. But I mean innovative at the edge of innovation. But then, when I think about that, I say, yeah, that's theoretically true. But now take a look at one of the three, four major things that we have to watch, I think, in the future of the world, which is nuclear fusion. Who is now kind of number one in this area? It's China.
China, yeah.
So.
And you think that's close to a breakthrough? I mean, I see a lot more money is going into it as an energy source.
Well, I mean, basically, it's very tempting to put money into this particular area because it is possibly a remarkable solution. I mean, it's like creating an artificial sun. So the first one to win that race, and by the way, Princeton is working it, Korea is working it, everybody's working it, it's not just China. But the one to win that race or to be ahead of, you know, is gonna benefit from that. And I cited just as an example, and same is true for artificial intelligence, same is true in other areas, cyber, you name it. Where China's made remarkable innovative progress, more frankly than I had anticipated. So you have to give them credit. And
so you would
that somehow has not stopped.
You would weigh China's advantages in cutting edge technologies more heavily than you would the constraints from demographics, lack of efficiency, indebtedness, zero COVID, all the rest. That's what you're
telling me. I think that's a good way of putting it, yes, yes. But that doesn't deny that those challenges exist. Those challenges really are there. There are, I mean, China is the only major economy in the world that has never gone through a really profound crisis the way we did in 2008.
That's a concern. And their willingness and ability to continue to kick the can down the road on big challenges like bad corporate debt or real estate bubbles and the rest.
And we all know what that leads to.
We don't, right. And are you saying that you think that China can continue to do that for the foreseeable future, or that you have a lot of uncertainty about your China projection?
China is better able to deal with those challenges than I had thought. And I give that to them. But I think, as you put it, in the balance, I think in that balance, I think their ability to do better than we might think is one that makes me, let's say, optimistic about their ability to become a true global power. In fact, the major true global power in the future.
Now,
not that that is a prospect, by the way, that I relish, because I don't think that is going to be a nicer world. I think it's going to be a much less nice world.